Welcome everyone to my talk. My name is Larisa Yaroslavtseva. I'm from the University of Ulm, and I would like to talk about sharp lower error bounds for strong approximation of stochastic differential equations with a discontinuous drift coefficient. My talk is based on joint work with Thomas Müller-Gronbach from the University of Passau. Okay, let me start with an introduction. Let us consider a scalar stochastic differential equation on the unit time interval within the initial value x0, drift coefficient A, diffusion coefficient B, which are mappings from R to R, and it's driven by a one-dimensional Brownian motion W. Our computational task is to approximate the solution of this SDE at the final time point by a method which is based on finitely many evaluations of the driving Brownian motion. Yeah? And we want to find a method which achieves a small LP error. In my talk, I'm interested in the case where the drift coefficient may have discontinuities. Yeah, and numerical analysis for such SDEs has started with this paper by Chong and Krylov in 1996, and it gained a lot of attention in the last few years. And in particular, papers which are marked by blue here, they study the LP approximation of the solution. Yeah, and that's what we are also interested in. And throughout my talk, I will present the results of these papers in more details, and I will in particular present the contribution, our contribution to the analysis of such SDEs. Okay, so let me first fix the assumptions on the coefficients, the particular assumptions which I will assume throughout the talk. So the drift coefficient may be discontinuous. More precisely, we assume that it may have finitely many discontinuity points, let's call them xi1 to xik. We denote by xi0 minus infinity, by xik plus 1 plus infinity, and we assume that the drift coefficient is Lipschitz continuous on each of the intervals xi I minus 1 to xi I. Yeah, so finitely many discontinuities points, and in between it's Lipschitz continuous. So in other words, the drift coefficient is piecewise Lipschitz continuous. This is our assumption A1, and the assumption A2 is that the diffusion coefficient is globally Lipschitz continuous on the whole real line, and it is not zero at the discontinuities points of the drift coefficient. And if these two assumptions are satisfied, that it's known that our SDE has a unique strong solution, yeah, it has been shown by Gunter Leobacher and Michaela Schilkini in 2016. So we have a unique strong solution, and the classical method to approximate this solution is the Euler scheme. Yeah, the Euler scheme with n steps is defined recursively as follows. At the point zero, it's just the initial condition of the SDE, and at the point L plus one, it's given by this right-hand side here. Yeah, and if it's a classical result, that in the classical case, when A and B are globally Lipschitz continuous, then for every P greater or equal than 1, the LP error of the Euler scheme is smaller or equal than some constant divided by n to the power of 1/2. Yeah, so the Euler scheme achieves the rate 1/2 in the classical case. And the performance of the Euler scheme has also been studied under for SDEs with a discontinuous drift coefficient, and in particular under the assumptions A1 and A2, the following results have been proven. The first result is due to Ngo and Taguchi. Yeah, they have considered a different set of assumptions on the coefficients, but it follows from the result that under A1 and A2, and additionally, the assumption that the drift is integrable and the diffusion is bounded and bounded away from zero, the Euler scheme achieves the LP error rate 1 over 2p for every p greater or equal than 1. Yeah, so we get rate 1 over 2p, and it gets worse with increasing p. Yeah. Then the second result is due to Gunter Leobacher and Michaela Schilkini. They have shown that under the assumptions A1 and A2, and additionally the assumption that the coefficients are bounded, the Euler scheme achieves the L2 error rate 1 over 4, up to an epsilon. So for p equal to 2, The rates here coincide, but Gunther and Michaela, they got rid of the assumption that the diffusion coefficient is bounded away from zero. Okay, so this was the results for the classical Euler scheme, and then Gunther and Michaela have constructed a transformed Euler scheme. It's when the SDE is first transformed to an SDE with global Lipschitz continuous coefficients. And then for this new SDE, we run the classical Euler scheme and then we transform it back. Yeah. And this method has been shown to achieve the L2 error rate 1/2. Yeah. But this method has a drawback, at least in the multidimensional case, namely that the inverse of the transformation is not known. And so the method is not implementable in general. And so then Andreas Neunkirch, Michaela Schulgeni, and Lukas Spruch have constructed an adaptive Euler scheme. It's when the step size of the Euler scheme is adapted to the distance of the actual value of the scheme to the closest discontinuity point, yeah, of the drift coefficient. And it gets smaller the closer we are to one of the discontinuity points. And this method has been shown to achieve the L2 error rate almost 1/2, yeah, up to an epsilon. And this scheme is fully implementable, yeah, also in the multidimensional case. And then finally, in a joint work with Thomas Müller-Gronbach, we have shown that actually also the classical Euler scheme, yeah, does achieve the LP error rate 1/2 for every P greater or equal than 1 under the assumptions A1 and A2, as it is the case for SDEs with global Lipschitz continuous coefficients. We have proven this result only for scale SDEs so far, but we think we can extend it to a multidimensional setting as well. And let me also add this remark here. Yeah, so that, recently, Konstantinos Dariotis and Mata Gerenza have also obtained the L2 error rate 1/2 for the classical Euler scheme in the case when the diffusion coefficient is equal to 1, yeah, but under very, very weak assumptions of the drift coefficient. So only under the assumption that A is bounded and measurable. And this, of course, covers the case of bounded drift coefficients satisfying our assumption A1. Okay, so these are now three methods, 1/2 order methods, yeah, the transformed Euler scheme, adaptive Euler scheme, and the classical Euler scheme. And in a recent work with Thomas Müller-Gronbach, we have constructed the first higher order method for such SDEs. Yeah, so now, additionally to the assumptions A1 and A2, we impose a further assumption A3, namely that both the drift and the diffusion coefficients are differentiable on each of the intervals xi I minus 1 to xi I and have Lipschitz continuous derivatives. Yeah, so this is now an additional piecewise regularity assumption A3. And then we have shown, yeah, that if the coefficients satisfy now the assumptions A1 to A3, then there exists a sequence of measurable functions Tn from Rn to R, such that for all p greater or equal than 1, there exists a constant C, such that for all n and n, the LP error of the following approximation. The approximation is given by the function gn applied to the evaluation of w at the equidistant grid is smaller or equal than some constant divided by n to the power of 3 over 4. Yeah. And this approximation here, it's obtained by first transforming our SDE to an SDE with global Lipschitz continuous coefficients and then running a Milstein type scheme for this new SDE and transforming it then back. Yeah, so due to the lack of time, I do not present the concrete construction of this method, yeah, but it in any case, the method is of this form. It's some function applied to evaluations of the driving Brownian motion. Yeah, and at the same time, Andreas Neunkirch and Michaela Schulgeni have also obtained the rate 3 over 4, yeah, in the case when the diffusion coefficient is equal to 1 and the drift coefficient is bounded and piecewise 2 times continuously differentiable with bounded derivatives. Yeah, and they have shown that actually the classical Euler scheme achieves the L2 error rate 3 over 4 up to an epsilon in this case. Yeah, and this class of SDEs is then a subclass of SDEs with satisfying the assumptions A1, 2, 3. Okay, so we have here a higher order method. Yeah, it achieves the rate 3 over 4. And now it is natural to ask whether this rate can be improved. Yeah, whether we can find a method which is still based just on finitely many evaluations of driving Brownian motion, but which achieves a better rate than 3 over 4. And it turned out that the answer to this question is no. Yeah, the rate 3 over 4 cannot be improved in general. And in order to formally state this result, let us consider the following SDE. It has the initial value 0, the diffusion coefficient is 1, and the drift coefficient is given by the indicator function of non-negative numbers. Yeah, so this is our SDE now we consider, and we do not know an analytical representation of the solution of this SDE. But using just the definition of the strong solution, we can write x1 as this Lebesgue integral, yeah, over the drift term plus the stochastic integral, which gives us just w1. And this term is here is not a problem at all. We can approximate it with error 0, yeah, just by w1 itself. But this Lebesgue integral here is the difficult term. Yeah? And we have then shown the following result for approximation of the solution x1 of this SDE, namely that for every epsilon greater than 0, there exists a constant c greater than 0, such that for all p greater or equal than 1 and all n in n, the following holds. Yeah? So the smallest possible LP error that can be achieved for approximating x1 by any method based on finitely many evaluations of the driving Brownian motion. Yeah, so we take here infimum over all time points t1 to tn. They don't need to be equidistant. And we take here infimum over all measurable functions g. Yeah, so this smallest possible error is greater or equal than c divided by n to the power of 3 over 4 plus epsilon. Yeah, so the rate 3 over 4 can essentially not be improved, yeah, for this SDE. And it is straightforward to check that the coefficients of this SDE, they satisfy the assumptions A1, 2, 3. And so this means that the answer to our question is no. The rate 3 over 4 cannot be improved in general, yeah, under the assumptions A1, 2, 3. And let me now present you the sketch of the proof of this result, yeah, of this lower bound. I will fix an approximation g of wt1 wtn, and for simplicity I will analyze the L2 error, and I will assume that our discretization points, this is a uniform grid. Yeah, ti is I divided by n. I will need some notation. So w bar is the piecewise linear interpolation of our Brownian motion at the time points t0 to tn. Yeah, so if this is my Brownian motion w here, then w bar is this piecewise linear interpolation, w bar. Then b is w minus w bar. So this is the family, the respective family of Brownian bridges. Looks like this, something like this. This is my B. Now, I consider first the stochastic process B tilde, which coincides its distribution with B and which is independent of W. Yeah, so this is a further family of Brownian bridges. Let's say it looks like this. This is my B tilde. And now I use this process B tilde to define W tilde as the piecewise linear interpolation W bar plus B tilde. Yeah, so this will be something like this. This is W tilde. And now the point is, yeah, that this process W tilde is again a Brownian motion. It's again a Brownian motion, and it coincides with our original Brownian motion at the grid points, Ti. Yeah? And we then consider a new stochastic differential equation, which has the same initial value and the same coefficients as the original stochastic differential equation, but which is driven by our new Brownian motion W tilde. Yeah? And then the point is that one can show that the distribution of x1 and our approximation is the same as the distribution of this new solution x1 tilde and the same approximation. Yeah? And therefore, the L2 error, which we want to approximate, yeah, it can be rewritten as 1/2 times the same L2 error plus the L2 distance of our approximation to the solution of the new SDE at time point 1. And using now the reverse triangle inequality, we can estimate it from below by 1/2 times the L2 distance between the two solutions. Yeah, so this is an essential step in our analysis. We got rid of the particular abstract approximation g of wt1, wtn, and we now just have to analyze the L2 distance between these two solutions. How are we doing it? So for I from 0 to n, let us denote by delta I the L2 distance between the two solutions at the time point ti. Then I can rewrite ti, xti as xti minus 1, plus the Lebesgue integral with respect to the drift term, plus the increment of the Brownian motion over this interval here, yeah, ti minus 1 ti. And I can do the same for x tilde ti, yeah, at the time point ti minus 1, plus the drift term, plus the increment of the Brownian motion w tilde over this time interval. But since the two Brownian motions coincide at the grid points, yeah, they cancel against each other, and we obtain this representation for delta I squared. Yeah, this is this expected value here squared. Yeah, and using now the binomial formula with these two terms here, we can also rewrite it as wi minus 1 squared plus 2 times mi, where mi is just the expected value of the product of the two terms, plus di, and di is the expected value of the square of the second term. Yeah, so we obtain this recursive formula for wi squared in terms of wi minus 1 squared. And now let's analyze the mixed term mi and the term di. And let me start with mi, yeah, with the term mi. So we show that mi is greater or equal than 0. And I will give you just the heuristics for this. Yeah, so if we look at this expected value here, and we look at the case when this factor is non-negative. Yeah, so at such omegas for which xti minus 1 of omega is greater or equal than x tilde ti minus 1 of omega. Yeah. Since x, so now the intuition comes. Yeah, the solution xs on this time interval here, yeah, with a high probability it stays close to xti minus 1. And the same is true for x tilde s. It stays close on this interval to x tilde ti minus 1. So because the drift coefficient, yeah, it's increasing, it means that with a high probability, this difference here stays also non-negative, so that the whole integral stays non-negative with a high probability. Yeah, and the product is then greater or equal than 0. And you can play the same game with the case when the first term is smaller or equal than 0. Then with a high probability, the second term is also smaller or equal than 0, so that the product is greater or equal than 0. Yeah? So this means heuristics, yeah, intuition tells us that mi is greater or equal than 0. And we prove it formally, yeah, using the fact that the drift coefficient is increasing. Yeah, and employing a comparison theorem for SDEs, we show that the mixed term is indeed greater or equal than 0. So we can just forget about this term, and let us turn to the analysis of DI. Yeah, so analysis of DI. I assume that I is greater or equal than 1/2. Otherwise, I just estimate DI by 0 from below. So on the first step, what we do is we approximate XS here by a simpler random variable, ys, which is given by xti minus 1 plus ws minus wti minus 1. Yeah, so we just forget this term here. We skip this term. The integral from ti minus 1 to s, integrate a function xu greater or equal than 0 du. Yeah, in the formula for xs. We just forget this term here. And we approximate x tilde s. here by y tilde s, which is xti minus 1, plus the increment of the Brownian motion w, yeah, from t minus 1 to s. So we forget the respective drift term, but additionally we replace x tilde ti minus 1 by xti minus 1. Yeah? And we can do it because the two solutions, the tilde and the solution and the original solution, they are close to each other at the grid points. You can show it just by plugging in the quasi, so our scheme, this transformed Milstein scheme in between. Okay, so this means that we approximate our term di by this expected value here with ys and y tilde s in place of xs and x tilde s. Yeah? So the formally, we show that the error of this approximation is small enough. So let us now look at this expected value. We can rewrite, yeah, if we just rewrite this square as the double integral and we put the terms together, then we get 2 times the double integral, ti minus 1 to ti, of the probability that ys and yt are simultaneously greater than equal than 0, minus the probability that ys and y tilde t are simultaneously greater or equal than 0. Now let's analyze this integrand here, and for this we rewrite ys now in the following way. So we rewrite ws as bs, Brownian bridge, plus the linear interpolation v bar s, and now we just use the representation of this piecewise linear interpolation in terms of w at the grid points, and then you come to this representation of ys. So ys is xti minus 1 plus bs plus s minus ti minus 1 n times the increment of the Brownian motion over the interval ti minus 1 to ti. Yeah, and you do the same for y tilde, then you get here b tilde s, and here you get the increment of the tilde process, but it's the same as the increment of the process w because the two Brownian motions coincide at the grid points. Okay, so we have this representation. The three random variables here are independent, and therefore we can rewrite our integrand as this integral over R2. We integrate with respect to the solution, xti minus 1, and increment of the Brownian motion. And if you do it, what you are left with, yeah, with this integrand here. Probability that the Brownian bridge Bs is greater or equal than the number As, and Bt is greater or equal than At, minus the probability that Bs is greater or equal than As and B tilde t is greater or equal than At. And for a time point u, the number Au is given then by this formula here. Yeah, it's determined by the value of the solution xti minus 1 by the time point u and by the value of the increment of the driving Brownian motion. And now because B tilde t and Bs are independent, and because B tilde t coincides in distribution with Bt, we can rewrite this probability as the product of probabilities that Bs is greater or equal than As and Bt is greater or equal than At. Yeah, so we are now left with the analysis of this difference here. And because Bs and Bt are Gaussian random variables which are positively correlated, yeah, it is known from the literature that this difference is always greater or equal than zero. Yeah, for all s and t, x and delta is greater or equal than zero. And moreover, yeah, we were able to prove that this difference is bounded away from zero by some positive constant as soon as the time points s and t are not too close to the grid points. So more precisely, they lie in the interval ti minus 1 to plus 1 over 4 n, ti minus 1 over 4 n, and as long as the value of the solution and the increment of the Brownian motion lie in the interval 0, 1 over square root of n. Yeah, so this is a technical analysis. I don't go into the details of this analysis here. And using these two bounds, we now obtain that our approximation of the term di is greater or equal than some constant divided by n squared. It comes from the double integration over time, yeah, double integral. And then we have the probability that xti minus 1 lies in the interval 0, 1 over square root of n, and probability that the increment of the Brownian motion lies in the same interval. This probability is just some constant. And this probability, yeah, we could show that the solution behaves essentially like the Brownian motion at the time point ti minus 1. So we could show that this probability is greater or equal than some constant to the power 1 half up to an epsilon or 2 epsilon. Yeah, so altogether you end up with the lower bound n to the power 5 half plus 2 epsilon, and you have altogether n half terms di, and when you sum it up and take the square root for the L2 error, you get the lower bound, you end up with a lower bound 3 over 4 plus epsilon, as it was claimed. Good. So this was the sketch of the proof of this result, and in fact we have shown that our lower bound holds not just for this one SDE, but more generally for a whole class of SDEs. More precisely, we have shown the following result. Consider the following family of SDEs now, with an arbitrary initial value x0, diffusion coefficient is 1, and the drift coefficient A satisfies the following set of assumptions. So the assumption I, this is just the union of the assumptions A1 to A3, which we had in our upper bound. So more precisely, A is differentiable on each of these intervals and has bounded and Lipschitz continuous derivatives. The second assumption is that the drift really makes a jump. So the right and the left limits at the point psi I do not coincide. And the third assumption is that the drift is increasing. As you have seen, we used it in the proof of this example which I have presented. And the technical assumption is that the drift is bounded. If these conditions are satisfied, then for every epsilon greater than zero, the smallest possible LP error that can be achieved by any method based on n evaluations of the driving Brownian motion is greater or equal than some constant divided by n to the power of 3 over 4 plus epsilon. So we get this lower bound for a whole class of SDEs. Okay, so 3 over 4, the rate 3 over 4 cannot be improved as soon as you stay with evaluation of W at fixed time points, but we have an optimistic conjecture. Namely, we believe that one can beat this rate by a suitable adaptive method. That there exists an adaptive method which achieves an LP error rate 1 for all A and B satisfying our assumptions A1, 2, or 3. And the proof of this conjecture is work in progress. Okay, at this point I'm done and I would like to thank you for your attention.